this morning. We had a great Sunday service last Sunday morning. I know some of you may be interested in knowing Sister Mary Lou gave me an approximate number of 349 people in total attendance for last Sunday morning, which is pretty huge. Amen. We want to thank y'all for all the food, everything you've done to help that go smooth, and it did go as smooth as I've ever seen this Easter. And we had a Sunday service, and I told Brother Arnold we was talking about after it was over with. I think that if we'd have just went ahead, we'd have had a Pentecostal meeting up in here last Sunday morning. So I encouraged our choir this morning that we come back with that same mindset of worship this morning, that we've just come to have church, and whatever the Lord wants to do, that'd be great and okay. I need to make a couple of announcements before we get started. Reminder, kids, church, parents, if your child is going to camp, at least one parent must help out next Sunday in order to receive camp funds for the fundraiser. Thanks, and that's from Sister Amber. And I'm going to go ahead and say next Sunday morning, chicken strips, mashed potatoes, green beans, roll, and dessert. All funds go to kids' camp. The kids will be singing special, giving testimonies, and during lunch, so it's going to be dinner theater. It ain't just a fundraiser lunch. It's going to be lunch theater. Amen. And ain't nothing better than kids putting on theater, because they can mess up and be funnier than we can on purpose. And so also, Brother Joe gave me a note on the way up here. Men's retreat, have to know today if you're going, because he's got to call and make those arrangements. So please, please let him know so he can do that. And I hope that everybody's paying attention, because once we get things like that set in stone, it's real hard to go back afterwards and get people put in later. April the 10th also, there's going to be a missionary here, Brother Kerry Malden. Is he going to be both services or just Sunday morning? And ladies' Bible study, April the 12th. April 17th, a baby shower. Jordan Pointer, it's a boy. And it don't say what time that's going to be. I don't. P.M. after service. And I think I may have made it all the way through the announcements, unless somebody's going to correct me. And I don't see that. So, amen. Let's stand together and pray this morning. Oh, baptism service tonight. I just happened to remember. Amen. If you want to be baptized, please let us know. I had somebody hit me up just a few minutes ago, and I said, just wear whatever you're comfortable wearing. And I turned around and started off, and I turned around and said, I remembered your Wednesday night teaching. And I said, better rephrase that. At least have on a T-shirt and a pair of gym shorts that go to your knees. But please bring that if you're going to be baptized tonight. Let us know. We'd love to do that. We're going to be receiving a lot of people into membership next Saturday night at the spring banquet. There's still room to be signed up for that. We pretty much finished our classes, so everybody that was going to that class is going to become a member of the church, I believe. And some of them that hadn't been water baptized is going to be water baptized tonight. Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
Amen. Woo. What a time. Man, there ain't nothing like a water baptizing. When people's glad that they got saved, they're testifying about how the chains of drug addiction, how alcoholism, how that their broken marriage has been fixed, and God's put it back on the track. Amen. And they're just glad. Hey, I like to see somebody standing water. I'm just glad he saved me. Amen. And I just standing here in the water today, let everybody know that he saved me and changed my life. Hey, if that sounds good to you and you want to be water baptized, let us know. We'd love to be part of that service and have you be part of that service tonight. Father, we come to you this morning. We're so glad, Lord. I feel your spirit here this morning. Lord, we come to lift you up and to honor you today in this place. You're worthy, Lord, to be praised and given honor to today. Lord, I pray for everybody here today, Lord, that they'll receive from you, Lord. Lord, that they'll receive their needs met today. If they're lost, they'll be saved, bound, they'll be delivered. Lord, that people will receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost today in this service, Lord. Father, we pray, God, today, God, that your will would be done in this house this morning. Lord, let people be lifted up. Lord, we break the spirit of depression this morning in this house, Lord. Father, we bind the spirit of oppression this morning in this house, Lord. I know right now people starting to feel looser than they did when they got here, Lord, that they're starting to feel the liberty, Lord, of the Lord come upon them this morning. Lord, we give you honor and praise today. Amen. Won't you help us worship this morning?
Because Jesus touched the blind man and he made him see. He cast demons out of the man from Gadarene. I know he cleansed the leper too, and he made the lame brand new. He put hope back in a hopeless life. Oh, let me testify to you that I've been delivered.
Oh, the hold the devil had on me, he ain't got no more.
You see, it's been from sin he set you free. Cause when he set you free, you are free indeed. Yes, I've been delivered.
Oh, the hold the devil had on me, he ain't got no more.
I've been delivered
by the hand of the Lord.
I've been delivered.
praise him this morning. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, I'm thankful to be delivered this morning. Hallelujah. You've been delivered this morning. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Oh, because the hold the devil had on you, Derek, he ain't gone no more. Oh, Ashley, you've been delivered.
You've been delivered.
What? You've been delivered.
You've been delivered.
Church, we've been delivered by the hand. If you haven't been delivered this morning, it's a fine time to get that way.
Amen.
I'm telling you, the Lord is here specifically to deliver those that are oppressed and depressed and bound by the chains of this world and the things that Satan binds you with. They're nothing for God. It's nothing for God. It's nothing for God to deliver you from that. You've already been delivered. You just got to accept that deliverance and take hold of it and declare to yourself, self, flesh, Satan, get out of my way, because I have been delivered. I have been delivered. Oh, the hold that the devil thought he had on me, he ain't got no more. Been delivered by the hand of the Lord. Hallelujah. Folks, we're not trying to pump you or prime you or recreate any type of atmosphere. I'm telling you, I feel this. I feel it in my feelers. I feel that rising up in me that I've been delivered, Sister Becky. Everything that Satan, Sister Susan, thought he had you entrapped with, all those pills he had you so hooked on that you couldn't even function without him, Sister Susan, now they sit collecting dust in a Ziploc bag somewhere far, far away. The things that you've been delivered from, Sister Rhonda, are somewhere else collecting dust, no longer to be picked up by you, because you've been delivered. You've been delivered, and whom the Son has set free, Sister Regina, is free indeed. And no longer do we have to subject to those things that have entrapped us our life, our whole life. I'm telling you this morning, if you are not delivered, if you don't feel what we feel, if you think, man, they're just trying to make somebody shout. No, I'm not trying to make anybody do anything. I feel a shout myself. I feel the spirit of excitement, of joy rising up in me. Church, this morning we're not trying to make anything. We're trying to proclaim to you that we have been delivered. Derek, long before you and Sister Nikki came to this altar, you were delivered. Long before you made that decision, y'all's deliverance was already there. You just had to go and reach down and pick it up. So if you think this morning, well, they've all got something that I can't attain to or that I can't find, I can't ever get there. Friend, you're mistaken. It's already been bought and paid for. The price has already been paid. The battle has already been won. And last week we celebrated the resurrection of our soon coming King. And I've seen it a million times on Facebook. And I'll tell you, if you don't have Facebook, everybody was posting this thing. It said, go ahead and celebrate again today because he's still alive. Friends, he is still very much alive. And he is still ready to work on your behalf.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Well, I see a battle raging deep inside of me. My spirit wants to worship, but this body wants to flee. I hear the voice of Jesus say, child, are you hungry for me? Oh, so I'm today, right now. Say with us, I take the victory. Somebody say with us, I take the victory. Well, for in the name of Jesus, I take the victory. I take His word and truth power. Well, I see my problems coming down, demolished at my feet. And in the name of Jesus, I take the victory. Well, now Satan tries to bind me, tries to keep me from my goal. But in the name of Jesus Christ, this sickness has to go. The curse of sin is broken, and I have His life in me. So in the name of Jesus, I take the victory. Well, in the name of Jesus, I take the victory. Yes, I take His word. Through power, I have authority. Well, I see my problems coming down, demolished at my feet. Jesus, I take the victory. Cause our body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. My spirit shouts in triumph to the one I love the most. I'm covered by His precious blood, by His power I'm free. I will give no room to the devil. I take the victory. For
in the name of Jesus, I take the victory. I take His word and Jesus, I take the victory.
Well, now Satan tries to bind me, tries to keep me from my goal. But in the name of Jesus Christ, this sickness has to go. The curse of sin is broken. I have His life in me. So in the name of Jesus, I take the victory. Well,
in the name of Jesus, I take the victory. I take His word and through His power, I have authority.
Jesus, I take
glory.
Well, I take His word.
I have authority.
Well, I can
see my problems coming down. Demolished at my feet.
Oh, for
in the name of Jesus, I take the victory.
Take it now.
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 Oh, for God said you can have it. Jesus died to give it. Holy Ghost is here right now. Well, just see your problems coming down, demolished at your feet.
And in the name of Jesus, you take the victory.
Take it now.
Take it now.
Take it now.
Take it now. Jesus died to give it, and the Holy Ghost is here right now to see that you don't miss it.
For God
said you can have it. Jesus died to give it, and the Holy Ghost is here right now to see that you don't miss it.
For
God said you can have it.
Jesus died to give it,
and the Holy Ghost is here right now to see that you don't miss it.
For
God said you can have it.
I am here to declare this morning that there are some of you that long so much to be free from the things that are binding you, from the things that are holding you. And I declare to you this morning that the word of the Lord says that whom the Son has made free is free indeed. And if you will step out and you will take your victory and you will claim to the devil that you will no longer be bound by sin and by those things that are besetting you, that you will be free today. Your freedom is here today. Hallelujah. come to tell somebody this morning that God is not dead, but He is very much alive, and He is here. He is here for your freedom this morning.
Hallelujah.
We can't sing your freedom to you. You can't shout your freedom down. You can't do things good enough for God to give you your freedom. His word says you are worthy. No matter how unworthy you feel right now, my friend, can I tell you that everyone in this building at one point in their life has been there, maybe even more. Brother Terry, it's been several times, more times than I even care to mention, that I felt unworthy of God's grace. But Brother Terry's word says that we are worthy because of the sacrifice that God made in giving His Son, and He let Him shed His blood for my sins. Brother Derek, if I did something so great for you, if I gave my child's life for you, Brother Joey, if I gave my child for you and I shed her blood was shed for your sins, I would so long for you to walk in that freedom. I would so long for you to say, God, here I am. I take the victory that you are trying to give me, that you have already won. The battle has been won. It's not something that we have to do today. We don't have to go kill sheep and all those lambs. And we don't have to put that blood over the door, Brother Doug, anymore, because it's been done. God took care of it one time. And it's done. It's for eternity. Brother Joe, every time that we need God's grace, it's available for us. And I'm telling you this morning that if you need victory in this house, it is here. And it is freely flowing. You don't have to jump around and act crazy like we do. You don't have to do anything except for just, I dare you to lift your hands and say, God, the victory that has been won, I declare it over my life. The price that has been paid, I accept that. And I take the victory. Hallelujah. This morning, God, we come before you. God, and we are in awe of your presence. God, we are in awe of the price that you paid. God, the victory that has already been won. That no matter how bad we mess up and how far gone we are, God, we are never too far for your arm's reach. We've never went too low. We've never done anything so bad, God, that you will not love us back. Because you paid the ultimate sacrifice. God, you gave your Son, your only Son, so that we might live eternally and that we might walk in freedom and peace. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. For we are standing on holy ground, and I know that there are angels all around. Let us pray.
hearts to him. Let's sing it one more time.
Lord Jesus, we are standing on holy ground.
Lord, we just bless you this morning.
Oh, and I know that there are angels all around. Let's praise.
Let us praise
Jesus now.
For
we are standing in his presence on holy ground.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What a privilege it is to be in the presence of God. What an awesome, awesome place to be this morning. We're just going to continue to worship him. We're going to worship him in this communion service. Our ushers come. As we prepare to take this communion meal together, I thought as we were singing, and my mind was where we were going, and I thought about Jesus said that there's going to come a day when he's going to sit at the table with us. And we are going to have that communion meal with him together. Is that exciting or what? I don't know about you, but this world don't look like it's going in the direction I really want to go. But Jesus has a place prepared. Matter of fact, he said, don't let your heart be troubled. Got a lot of trouble today in people's lives, but Jesus said, don't let that happen. If you believe in Father, believe also in me, for in my Father's house there's many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. And where I am, there you may be also. He's did a lot, more than we could ever imagine. The Apostle Paul writing, and I know we read this every time we take communion. There is other scriptures, but I just like this. He said, I've received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do you as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you show the Lord's death till he comes. That's what we're doing today. We're making a proclamation in here of what Jesus has already accomplished. As she was talking about deliverance and all of those things. Salvation, it's already been paid for. It's already ready for you to receive. All you need to do is receive it by faith. We're going to pray. I want you to come. They're going to continue to play. We're going to come and be served this morning, the communion meal. We'll return back to your seat. We'll all take the communion together. Father, right now, I pray that God, your Spirit, which is already here, would move among the hearts of your people, Lord, this morning. The realization, Lord, of your presence will become even more demonstrated to lives, Lord, here. God, as we feel your precious presence and know, Lord, that you're here. We ask, God, that you touch hearts this morning that have not been touched in a long time or maybe never by your Spirit. Lord, that you'll awaken men and women. As the eyes of the two servants was opened on the way to Emmaus, Lord, may eyes be opened this morning. May hearts, God, be find revelation of you. We give you praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you come this morning and be served? If you're new, you can just kind of follow the lead of those around you. we take this bread this morning, Father, we thank you for the sacrifice given for each one in this room and all humanity. The body of your Son Jesus was offered at the whipping post and at Calvary. And every stripe that was laid upon that back, representing the disease and infirmities that would come against man, would be healed through Jesus. We thank you for that today and receive that by faith. Give you praise and glory for it and honor as we take this bread in representation of his body. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's take the bread. As we lift this cup, represents the precious blood, as Sister has already made reference to. We don't have to have a goat slain or a lamb slain outside or a bull and come in here and sprinkle us. The precious blood of Jesus has already paid the price and has covered our sins and our iniquities. Thank God for that. This cup represents that precious blood. Father, we thank you for it. We bless the name that is above every name, the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and give honor and praise unto him. Amen. Let us take the drink. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That precious blood that shed. Amen.
Oh, what love. No greater love. Grace, how can
Daniel, it's already been good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Amen. Our ushers are going to come this morning. Amen. We was teaching in class today, and I talked a little bit about tithing in the class, the membership class this morning. You know, I think sometimes we almost feel like we got to apologize for talking about tithing, but I really, really explained to them this morning. I wish that I'd have got the concept of tithing when me and Rhonda would have first got in church, Brother Arnold. I believe that I would have been a lot better off if I, Brother Derek testified this morning about how that God had just done things for them because they've been honoring God in their finances. Amen. And I'll tell you, you find anybody in this church, I challenge you, find anybody that's been tithing, and see if they don't have a testimony to offer about how God has been faithful to them. Amen. As a matter of fact, if God has been faithful to you and you're a tither this morning, I want you to raise your hand if God has been faithful to you. Amen. That's quite a testimony this morning of God's faithfulness. And that's not me. That's for your benefit. As I told the class this morning, that's for your benefit. If I could have learned this when I was 22, whenever we first got in church, 24, something like that, man, it would have been a great thing. But I encourage you today to be faithful to God and see if he's not faithful. He said he'd stand at the edge of your field and rebuke the devourer as he tried to come in. Amen. He'd provide for your needs according to his riches and glory. Amen. Well, Father, we come to you this morning, Lord. We're thankful, God, for this part of the service. God, we ask you to bless, God, those that are given this morning. I pray, God, that you will make greater testimonies in their life, Lord. For those that are looking for employment today, God, we pray that you're going to put them in the place that you have prepared for them. God, for those that are looking for promotions, God, we pray, God, that you're going to give them favor today. Lord, I pray that you'll bless people's jobs and their businesses, Lord. As I heard this week, Lord, that the unbelieving bosses, God, were blessed because of the believing workers. Lord, I pray, God, that these businesses will be blessed, God, because of these workers, Lord, that we're going to send back into their places, Lord, that everything they set their hand to, Lord, you'll bless it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Sister Megan's here already. Oh, here she comes.
I used to explain.
I'm glad I got a Savior. I'm glad I know His name. I'm glad He knows my name. Amen. What an exciting day to be at the house of God. Every Sunday is Easter to me because I live in His resurrection power. I'm walking in His resurrection power. The Apostle Paul said that I might know Him, the fellowship of His suffering, and the power of His resurrection. Amen. He's did it. He's did it. He did it right. Nothing left to be done except for us to follow Him, trust in Him, have faith in Him. We're glad that you're here this morning. I'm going to get right into the Word of God. I want you to turn with me today to the book of 1 Samuel, chapter number 16. While you're turning there, I want to recognize lifelong friends. Well, not lifelong friends, but years of friendship that have been between me and Brother Chris and Sister Joyce Longoria. It's good to have them in service. Stand up, Brother Chris, Sister Joyce. Amen. Woo! It's good to have them. Amen. Brother Chris has been ministering and working, I know, in church out in New Mexico and Arizona area, but they're back. They're back living in Russellville. And we're going to have him out to preach some Sunday night for us, and looking forward to that. I saw him the other day at Lowe's, and I don't know how long you been gone. 7, and Sister Joyce is getting younger, so I'm going to move to New Mexico when I start looking old, and then come back. But it's good to have them. I thought about when I was in. Brother Dempsey and Sister Vicky, or Sister Wendy Vickers, ain't here today. Or if they have moved. That's why you don't move. Good thing I said, going to say something good. which that's all I can say about Brother Dempsey, something good. And Sister Wendy. But I thought about, I'm trying to figure out how I can pit them together in a game of spoons. Yeah. Two of the most competitive women that I know are in the same building together. So anyway, as far as games go. So you're in 1 Samuel this morning. I believe that I've heard from God this morning concerning what I'm going to talk to you about. I made this statement the other day. When I preach the Word of God, it's God speaking to you, and it's not me, okay? Don't look at the package. Listen to the. Don't even really be concerned with the presentation, but listen to what the Word says. I believe that we're living in a very strategic time in the world today. I believe Jesus is coming soon. A lot of people acknowledge that and are not doing absolutely anything about it, not preparing themselves, not preparing their families. I'm going to tell you something, folks. We have this ideal that God just gonna, you know, he's got a certain number that he's got to have, and so you know, we just do, you know, just do whatever. We need to be preparing ourselves and our families for the last day, and we're in the last days. But you know, I was thinking this week, God is going to do what God's going to do on this earth in the last days through you and I, through the church. He's not going to change vehicles. Not this late in the game. It's the church. He has empowered us. He's given us absolutely everything we need to turn the world upside down. You find that in Acts chapter number 11. They said, hey, these are the men that are turning the world upside down. And I'm afraid that we have conceded to the work of the enemy and no longer feel superior in the fight. But I'm telling you, Sister Betty made note of this. I want to tell you something. We have the greatest weapon. It's greater than the H-bomb, the atomic bomb, any nuclear powers that there can be. The weapon God has given us is greater, and it's the weapon of prayer. It is powerful. The Word of God is another weapon that's in our arsenal. It is powerful. The Bible said it's quick and powerful. Sharper than any two-edged sword, dividing asunder soul and spirit, bone and mind. I'm telling you, it knows the very intents of our heart this morning. what God has placed in us is unconquerable by the enemy. Only if you yield it up to him can he take your weaponry from you. So in 1 Samuel this morning, I'm going to talk about what it takes to get to where God wants you to be. You know, I'm going to have to be convinced that there's not anybody in this room attained yet where God wants us to be. And I myself included in that. But I'll tell you, I just, in my prayer this morning, I said, God, I just want to be just right in the center of your will. That's where I want to be. I don't want to be off a little bit. When we were building my house, and I have had the privilege, and I count it a privilege, to have helped Sister LaQuita's dad and her grandfather build several houses, and I've helped them on that. And it's a great honor to work with people that are precise. And Brother Terry knows what I'm talking about. Brother Randy, he don't want it a 16th off when he's measuring, because he said by the time we get to the end of this thing, it'll no longer be a 16th off. It'll be a foot off or whatever. And that's the way I want with my life. I want to be precise in what I'm doing. I don't want to just, throw it out there and get pretty close. Just get pretty close. I want to be spot on, because I believe, and why I'm preaching this morning, I believe God has got people sitting in this room he's ready to blow out of and make a difference in the community and in the world. If we can just get to that place to where we allow him to. And how are we going to do that? Well, 1 Samuel chapter number 16. And I've got quite a bit of reading to do, so I'll speed read here as much as I can. We're going to be going down through verse number 12. A very familiar story. If you've been in church very long at all, you've probably heard the story of David, the king of Israel. And this is where he got his start. It's the beginning of his start. And I believe today that every successful person in the kingdom of God is going to have this start right here. Okay? You're going to have to be called of God. You're going to have to be empowered by God and sent by God. Any other way, you're going to fail. You're going to falter. Well, preacher, and let me say this, we're all called of God. Now, the rest of it, we have to allow to happen. But listen to this story. And the Lord said unto Samuel, how long wilt thou mourn for Saul, seeing I have rejected him from reigning over Israel? Fill your horn with oil and go. I will send you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided me a king among his sons. And Samuel said, how can I go? If Saul hear it, he will kill me. And the Lord said, take a heifer with you and say, I am come to sacrifice to the Lord. And call Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what you shall do. And you shall anoint unto me him whom I name unto you. And Samuel did that which the Lord spake, and came to Bethlehem. And elders in the town trembled at his coming, and said, comest thou peacefully? Peaceably. And he said, peaceably, I am come to sacrifice unto the Lord. Sanctify yourselves, and come with me to the sacrifice. And he sanctified Jesse and his sons, and called them to the sacrifice. And now we got the selection process is fixing to begin. And it came to pass when they were come that he looked on Eliab and said, surely the Lord's anointing is before him. But the Lord said unto Samuel, look not on his countenance or on the height of his stature, because I refused him. For the Lord seeth not as man seeth, for the man looketh on the outward appearance, but the Lord looketh where? On the heart. The Lord looks on the heart. Then Jesse called Abinadab and made him to pass before Samuel. And he said, neither hath the Lord chosen this. Then Jesse made Shammah to pass by. And he said, neither hath the Lord chosen this. Again, Jesse made seven of his sons to pass before Samuel. And Samuel said unto Jesse, the Lord hath not chosen these. And Samuel said unto Jesse, are here all thy children? And he said, there remaineth yet the youngest, and behold, he keepeth the sheep. And Samuel said unto Jesse, send and fetch him, for I will not sit down till he come hither. and he sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy and with all of a beautiful countenance and goodly to look to. And the Lord said, arise, anoint him, for this is he. Father, we thank you today. What a blessed story. God, what a truth. What revelation. May it flow, God, from this vessel into the ears and hearts of this people today. And we give you praise and glory in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. You may be seated. I believe we're living in a time that can be parallel to the time of David's calling and rising from the obscurity of the backside of a field among a few sheep that his brother will point out a couple chapters over. Eliab was said, who's staying with that few sheep while you're down here looking at the battle that's going on with Goliath? So we got the story here that's set. God is preparing, amen, to change, if you will, leadership in his people. Now, how they got to this place was through the rejection of God. You remember when God told Samuel, the people begin to demand of Samuel, we want a king. Why do you want a king? We want to be like everybody else. We want to be like all the nations around us. They've got kings. They're set up. And Samuel made a plea with them. He said, don't you know that if you put a king over you, he's going to be able to take your children and he's going to rule over them. They'll be fighting and going to war and you'll have no control over that. That'll be up to the king. They said, we don't care. We want a king. And the Bible says that Samuel went to God, and he said, God, these people are rejecting. He said, listen, Samuel, they're not rejecting you. They're rejecting me because they want a king. They're no longer satisfied with the leadership that they have by my spirit. Now, amen, they want a man to do it. And so he said, they're not rejecting you. They're rejecting me, but I'm going to find somebody, and I'm going to give them somebody to rule them. The Bible says that God chose Saul, and he sent old Samuel down there to anoint Saul. The Bible tells us that God had to do something in Saul, amen, to qualify him. He was big enough. Matter of fact, the Bible says he was head and shoulders above everybody else in Israel. But God had to do something. You remember what that was? The Bible says that God had to give him a new heart. He had to take and reprogram him and get him to where he could do something. But, even though in today's culture that we have in society, we got people that seemingly want to do something for God, and it seems like God's done something in their life. Amen. Many times that has come through what we could view as incidents, amen, that they're serving God because of some reason. I believe that Saul was one of them people that served God in the kingship because, amen, that he had a change of heart that wasn't his change of heart, but had been initiated and really brought to pass by God. Amen. You know, there's a lot of people in the church world today. They go to church because of a tragedy, amen, that may have happened in their life. They go to church because mom and daddy went and took us to church, so now we feel obligated to go to church. Or there's even people that go to church because our kids need to be in church, so we go to church with them. Amen. Whatever the cause may be, they're really there, but their heart is not in it. And that's what we're going to talk about tonight. Amen. I'm going to entitle this message, When All You Have Is All God Needs. Amen. You see, God, amen, began to pick out. He picked out Saul. Amen. Put a new heart in him. But the Bible begins to develop the story how Saul, amen, began to be a man that pursued his own ambitions. He cared more about what people thought about him than what God thought about him. As a matter of fact, when God began to rebuke him through Samuel, Saul said, listen, go ahead and let me sacrifice in front of the people. Why? It was important to him that he be a people pleaser. Amen. His heart wasn't in pleasing God. It was in pleasing man. We've got that in our church world today. Amen. Where people are just wanting to please. They're doing it for notoriety. They're doing it for prestige or whatever the purpose is. And we're seeing a great decline in the spiritual realm in the house and through the house of God and through the children of God. But I believe that we're living in one of the most precious times that you and I could have ever lived in. I believe God, amen, is going to do away with the old Saul kingship mentality. And God is searching right now for men and women whose heart is bent upon pleasing God. Amen. I believe it's going to take that in this hour if we're going to see anything change in the spiritual realm. It's not going to come through people or doing it because it's a job. It's not going to come through ministries that they're in a ministry because they found out that might be where the money's at. Our daddy was a preacher. Our mama was a prophetess. Amen. So we're going to be one also. It's going to come through people, amen, who have a heart to serve God. The Bible tells us, God said to Samuel, the Bible tells us that he sought after a man who was after his heart. He didn't have to come in and change anything about David. David was a man who was already after the heart of God because his heart was for God. Amen. He's a man that God didn't have to do a lot of changing in, didn't have to correct all the time. He's a man who lived his life in obedience to what God wanted out of him. His very intellect and the things about what he thought about was for God. We find that when he goes down to Goliath. It wasn't about, hey, if I can knock this guy off, I can marry the king's daughter. It was about, this guy is defying the armies, not of Israel, but the armies of God. That's the kind of heart he had. He didn't want to go to a church, amen, that was just about music and about that. He wanted to be part of something that was coming against the powers of darkness of this world. He wasn't about, I can get a little higher if I do this. He was about, I am coming against kingdoms, amen, that are causing men and women to lose their families and lose their life and all this thing. That's where his heart was at. Amen. Most folks go to church because of something they can get. David wanted to be part of the kingdom for something he could do for God. Amen. So we find this story unfolding here. And we find that God, amen, sends Samuel down. And he passes. Samuel begins to pass all of them. Eliab is first. And he's big. And surely Samuel said, this is the guy. But it wasn't the guy. They go through six, seven of them. And now he said, is this all you've got? Amen. No, this ain't all I got. But it's all I think that you can use. You know what? We got a problem in the church world today. Many of you in this room, amen, can move into great areas of spiritual warfare and do great things. But the problem is you have no self-confidence. Amen. You don't. Nobody else thinks you can do it. And since nobody else thinks you can do it, you don't think you can do it. I see a great contrast, amen, among the church folks today in that wise. But I see that what we need is the spirit of David. It wasn't about what his brothers thought about him. It was about opportunity. If I can just get opportunity. See, where he was at, amen, on the backside of that field over there, he was already preparing himself for when God brought him out, and he didn't even know God was going to bring him out. But when the lion came and the bear came, he already was defending what he was put over. I believe if we can be faithful over what God puts us over, amen, when we're insignificant and small in our own eyes and in the eyes of our peers, I believe there's going to be a coming out party, amen, when God, amen, is going to begin to expose what is truly in the heart of men and women of God. Have you ever been shocked by somebody? Wow, I didn't know that was in them. I have been multiple times in my pastorate. I've seen people, I'm just like, where'd that come from? It didn't just happen because a certain song was sung or a certain sermon. It happened beforehand, Sister Betty, in the preparing of the heart. Oh, man, David, you know, I don't know the story. I've heard a lot of speculations. Amen, the Bible says he's ruddy, amen, a small countenance. You know, he's a good-looking guy, amen, but he don't fit none of the protocol that you would think a warrior would fit. But that doesn't stop him, because God is not looking like everybody else is looking. God's looking on the inside. What would God be looking on the inside for? Because that's where the heart of David's at. And he said, I've been looking everywhere. Amen. I rushed around and put Saul in, had to change his heart. Amen. But that heart didn't stay changed. So I'm finding me somebody who's already changed their heart. I don't have to do anything with the heart. All I got to do is get them to work, and they begin to go forward. We're living in a church world today, and I know what I'm preaching is very unpopular, and it's fixing to get worse. But we're living among a people today who are divided in their heart. They're committed to God on religious days, like Sundays, and not even really totally committed to that. Just enough to ease the conscience and say we've been to church. Going to church will not get you to heaven. A relationship with Jesus is what it takes. If going to church got me to heaven, and I can relate that to my marriage, me and my wife, amen, would hardly know each other. But our marriage is not based upon when I come home. Our marriage is based upon our relationship. Well, let me move on. In the book of Hosea, chapter number 10, we're going to go there real quickly. And you can find it because I didn't mark it, and you can find it as quick as I did. Well, maybe not. I'm there now. Amen. The Lord surprised me. Amen. But look in Hosea chapter number 1, or chapter number 10, verse number 1. Israel is an empty vine. He bringeth forth fruit unto himself. Listen to the selflessness of this church, of Israel. It's an empty vine. He bringeth forth fruit unto himself. According to the multitude of his fruit, he hath increased the altars. According to the goodness of his hands, hath made goodly images. Look in verse number 2. The problem with Israel was their heart is divided. Now shall they be found faulty. He shall break down their altars. He will spoil their images. What was Israel's problem? God said, I found out that their heart is divided. Let me just catch you up on this story. The story is coming through Hosea the prophet. Hosea has been told of God, I want you to go down. I want you to marry a harlot. How many of you daddies and mamas are like that? I'm sure he wasn't the most popular prophet on the town square all of a sudden. He married a harlot. Now this whole story is an allegory of Israel. And so he says, go marry. He married her. They raised a couple daughters. And she runs off. Where does she go? Right back in to the lifestyle that she came from. Hello? What happens when men and women of the house of God, of the kingdom of God, amen, does not have their heart fixed? I'll tell you what happens. You begin to drift back to where you came from. You begin to take on the very personality that you spent so much time trying to get away from. Hosea Tucker got her out of the harlot clothes, put a ring on her finger, married her. She conceived, bore children to him, but she wasn't satisfied with all of that, so she drifted back. And she goes back. You read the story. She ends up on the auction block again. And here comes Hosea, a picture of Christ, a picture of God. And he redeems her again. Amen. Why? Amen. Because God loved her. Amen. And God loved Israel. But what God was trying to tell Israel was, you'll never get in this situation if you can stay with a single heart. But if your heart is divided, you're going to keep going back to her. That was Saul's problem. Amen. Saul tasted one taste of fame. And he couldn't get away from that. He had to be a people pleaser. God cannot use people pleasers. God's looking for somebody who has a single heart, and nothing else will take the place of God. It doesn't matter what goes on in your life. Amen. God will be number one. Amen. And if God be number one, Sister Betty was talking this morning about the favor of God. I don't think she ever used the word favor, but she got to talking about God. Spoke to her once and said, listen, I just want to surprise you sometimes with some good things. I'm going to tell you something. When your heart is single, amen, your eye will be single. But when you get in that place where your heart is about God, God will begin to bring favor into your life. Amen. you know, tithing. He talked about tithing this morning. Amen. Tithing is one of God's favors. Amen. That you don't have to do much to get a lot. Amen. But it does require obedience. But in the sixth chapter of the book of Matthew, chapter number 6, verse number 19, the Bible says, lay not up for yourself treasures upon the earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal. Most Christians today have broken this very commandment of God. If you want to view it as a commandment, lay not up for yourself treasures upon the earth. But it don't just stop there. But lay up for yourself treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Now, I know in this same passage of Scripture, he said, seek ye first the kingdom of God, amen, and its righteousness. All of these, some of you looking at me like I'm preaching blasphemy, but I'm telling you today, amen, if money is your God, you will die with it, amen, because we only have Fort Knox, and I don't even know if they got enough gold there to cover what's in circulation. They just run out and they keep printing more. Nothing backing it, nothing there. So I can tell you, in my Father's house are many mansions. In my Father's house, amen, there is wealth. He took the pearl, the greatest pearl he could find, and just made the city gate out of it. Oh, but we get to feeling confident when we get a little money in our hand. Hello? We get to feeling like, well, I'm blessed. Hallelujah. And we begin to get unfaithful to God. We were praising him when we was needing it. And when it came in, we forgot who brought it in. So, well, oh, we were fervent. I'm just going to preach it, can I? Amen. Our heart was all about God. Bless God. I'm seeking first the kingdom. But when God begins to bless, I'm telling you, you know why? I'm going to say this about Arnold Humphrey. Probably the reason why my bank account ain't no more than it is because God's given me all, amen, that I have the ability to manage. That was Arnold. Been a good time to say amen. But let me move on. Where is my heart? Because if my heart, amen, because from the treasures of your heart, the Bible said your mouth will begin to talk about what your heart, amen's all about. Have you ever seen Christians in the world we live in today? You can have all kinds of gatherings. You can have everything you want, and very little is said about Jesus, and very little is said about spirituality. All we want to talk about is carnal things. You know why? Amen, because that's where our heart is. And from the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. Don't look at me with that tone of voice. It's the truth. It's the word of God. Amen. Our heart, amen, will tell us where we're at with God. You can't carry on a spiritual conversation with most Christians. Brother Doug, they'll come to your house, and if you have a Bible study, they won't come back. But if you'll have a pool party, bless God, clean that thing out. Hurry up. We want to come down. We're going to barbecue. We're going to jump off the diving board. We're going to do 3 somersaults and a flip. Same thing. Well, anyway, we'll make that last and look pretty good. Amen. But bless God, don't break out the Bible. Why? Well, because we get all that we want on Sunday. Amen. We just want to come and enjoy. But I'm telling you, when our heart gets full, amen, of the precious things of God, amen, I've got stopped this week on a track, amen, walking, and a lady told me, said, hey, and she knew I was a pastor, and she said, listen, when y'all pray, will you pray for me? Amen. I said, well, I'm not going right now. I said, come down Sunday. We'll lay hands on you. And we'll pray for you. People are getting healed in church. Amen. It's time that we begin to let our mouth, amen, expose a heart that believes in God, that's not divided, amen, that we're not ashamed of him, that we'll stand up in this hour, because there is a darkness that is trying to prevail in our country today. There's a Goliath that's roaring in the middle of the valley, but God's looking for hearts, amen, that he can move on, that'll stand in front of the big 9-foot giant and say, listen, I don't know about all this armor, but this I know. Amen. You're not going to defy the armies of the living God. I don't come to you with a sword. I can't wear Saul's armor, but I can come to you in the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Woo. I mean, church folks, it ain't going to do no good to dress up, amen, for this battle. Because if David hadn't had the heart to whoop Goliath, But his mouth exposed where his heart was at. His mouth exposed. Ain't nobody going to come against the armies of the living God. Ain't nobody going to defy God. Amen. I may be small. I may be Rudy. I looked up that word. He's red. He's fair complexion. Amen. Matter of fact, a lot of scholars believe that old David might not even been Jesse's son. Amen. They think that he may be, amen, come in the wrong manner. Amen. And that's the reason why he's rejected. He's pushed on the back. I'm not preaching that as the gospel. I'm just telling you some scholars believe, because even in the psalmist, in the Psalms, David alludes to the fact, amen, that he's not liked. He's kind of despised. But I don't know about all that. But what I do know, what we do know about him, is he had a heart for God. Amen. He wanted to please God. And he wasn't going to let hell, amen, rise up. He watched as his 6-7 brothers, amen, over in the holes of the rocks. Amen. And they're big and they're strong. But they can't come against the powers of God. We've got mega churches through the land. We've got little churches through the land. Amen. We got all kinds of churches in America, but still hell is coming and engulfing our nation. It's time that America's churches get a heart for God and stand up and say, we've had enough. We call on God. Hallelujah. We'd rather have a committee meeting. We'd rather have a conference. And most time we ain't even got the heart to go to them, because nothing's going to change. We're like the most defeated of everybody. Amen. As it was yesterday, so will it be today. But I said, God, I want a heart to rise up in this preacher. Amen. That's not like, amen, the norm. I want it to be abnormal. I want to wake up in the middle of the night, amen, praying in tongues. Amen. Saying, God, I've called the east and I call the west. I want to be like Ezekiel. I want to speak to the four winds and let them blow on dead, dry bones. And they're an exceeding mighty army. Raise up. We can do it if we can ever get our heart fixed. If we can ever get a heart for God like our forefathers had. Amen. That knew how to pray, knew how to seek God until God answered. So we must have this heart that God had for a heart of God. We can't have a divided heart will take you in two different directions. James said it like this: a double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways. He said, let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. How come? Because while part of his heart is saying God can do it, the other part of his heart saying there's been failures in the past, and is this just going to be another failure? Amen. A double-minded man can't get there. A double-hearted person will not bring revival to this much-needed land that we live in. It's going to take a church who is ready to give up the world's pleasures and all the amenities of the world and say, listen, I'll lay it down. I'll lay it down to pick up the cross to follow him. I don't care where I could be out there in this world. One of the most tragic things, and we see it all the time, for you that watch The Voice and American Idol, we see people who got their start in church but got an opportunity, amen, to go higher through the secular system. And now they're not a voice for God in the secular scene. They're not a voice. No, they're snowballed. I'm telling you, I'm going to say this. It's going to hair lip. Amen. I don't mean that bad and disrespectful, but it's going to be bad. I read an article the other day. Amen. How God uses me. Amen. Through sports. Why the Lord wants me to play sports on Sunday. Yeah. Uh-huh. Come on now. Look up here. Look up here. There's a call to house of God that God in his word, amen, has admonished us to go and to worship together, amen, at that place, amen, corporately. Some of you don't like what I'm saying, but I come as the mouthpiece of God. When everything is going under and hell's coming against your home, wherever your heart is going to make a difference in how God responds to you. Somebody said, I'll just quit paying tithes. Go ahead. I've still got my CDL. Brother Roy will let me drive a log truck. Brother Jamie will let me work for Brother Tony. I'll do whatever I have to do, but I'll not go out of this life holding back the truth. I'm going to tell you the reason why, amen, we've got such conditions in the United States is because the church has went back to a double-hearted standard, and we no longer, amen, worship God. Amen, we have idols, amen, that we bow to. Fishing, hunting. I'm not talking about vacations. I'm not talking about time. I'm talking about habitual things. I've had people tell me, now, Pastor, you won't see me for an X amount of time. I'm not concerned if I see you or not. God's concerned if he can find you. Woo! Boy, I done preached myself. This is good stuff. You need to come on Wednesday night if you want to hear me rant. Hey, my Brother Terry, I'm telling you, I thank my wife or Brother Jimmy. I said, Brother Jimmy, it's Thursday morning. I said, if I don't get under control, I'm going to kill Wednesday night. But I'm telling you, I've been preaching on premarital sex, adultery, and fornication for the last 2 weeks. Why? Because it's sin. Woo! It's sin. And it has no place in it. Well, I don't want to get there. Amen. Because I want to stay. God is going to raise up. I believe this. I heard it this morning. Amen. In my office, I heard it. I heard it resounding in my spirit. Amen. Because God is speaking to me. If I can get some men and women who will get a heart for God, God's going to raise up a nation, an army. If you will, go to the book of Joel and you'll find it there. In the book of Joel, he said, rend your hearts and not your garments. You're going to get anywhere with God? Quit pretending. Quit trying to make some kind of sacrificial motion and get your heart into this thing. Man, Proverbs 4:23 said, keep your heart with all diligence. For out of it flows the issues of life. Oh, my God. Folks, if we could just see the importance of having our hearts surrendered to God, if we could just see that in the most darkest hour of your life, when your marriage is failing, when your children are rebelling, when your taxes, amen, are overwhelming you, and when your finances, amen, are going under, if you could just see what a perfect and upright heart before God would mean to you in that hour, you would receive what I'm saying to you today. But while you're in all of your pleasures, when everything's going good and you're getting a big check back from the IRS instead of paying it in, everything seems okay. But honey, when you go down to the unemployment line and there's no job, when you go down to get your EBT card and they say you don't qualify, amen, when you look to the right and you look to the left and you can't find no help, I'm going to tell you something. If your heart's right before God, you can look to the hills from which cometh your help. Your help will come from the Lord. It may be at the midnight hour. It may be when all that's above the water is your nose. But I can tell you, before you take your last breath and drown, the hand of the Lord is going to reach down and he's going to pick you up. Why? Because he knows them whose heart is upright and perfect before him. Now, this ain't for everybody. I understand that. But it's for me. Because my desire, whoo, the Lord this morning began to deal with me. Yeah. Woo. He said they're looking for somebody that will be Michael Jordan's equal. They're looking for somebody. We thought it was Kobe Bryant. He had to retire before he reached that mark. It may be old King himself. Hey, man, up there in Cleveland. that finally breaks down all those records. Amen. But we keep on looking. But Jesus spoke to me this morning, and he said, "Preacher, you don't have to look any further, because I'm the King of Kings, and I'm the Lord of Lords, and they'll never be." He said, "There'll never be anybody that will be able to grant you unto you what I have granted unto you." He said, "There'll never be another that's able to hang on a cross and endure the shame, because I have." He said, "There'll never be another that'll shed his lifeblood, but I have." He said, "There'll never be another raised from the dead, but I have." Hallelujah.
Glory to God.
Woo! And that's why my heart is set like an adamant stone this morning. Oh, we used to sing, "You'll take the whole world, but give me Jesus." Now we say, "Amen, give us the whole world, amen, along with Jesus." But I can tell you, it don't happen that way. But I can tell you, if you'll seek him and you'll set your heart on him, I can tell you, there'll begin to be a river flow out of your life that'll bring life in the most dry and desert times of your life. Some of you still ain't got over the sporting thing. You need to get over it. I feel that in my spirit. Hello. Holy Ghost done told me. I plowed a little close to the corn. But I can tell you what'll happen. You're going to move in the dirt around the roots, and the corn will grow. Hello, that's why we plow. If we're just getting weeds out, we can pull them out. But plowing's important. Because plowing moves those roots around, and it brings moisture up. Woo, I'm telling you what, so let me plow a little while. Amen. Because I can tell you something. Huh? We are living in the most crucial time. If I ask you individually, every one of you is knowing. You've watched the news. You've seen, my God, what are we going to do? If I was a Democrat this morning, I'd be over at a corner sucking my thumb somewhere. Be over yonder behind Brother Tommy. If I was a Republican, I'd get in that corner. I'd suck my right thumb. If I was a whatever, no name, what are they? Independent. I'd be back there sucking my thumb. Because we ain't got no choice. Woo! If you're looking for a political revival that will bring this nation back to it, Donald Trump said, "I'm going to make it a great nation." No, Donald Trump ain't, because the devil's done got in here, and the devil's the one that destroyed. And then when the devil destroys, the only one that'll make it great is the one, amen, who put him in his place, and that's Jesus Christ. If we're going to bring this nation back to its greatness, we got to put the king back on the throne, and his name is Jesus. Jesus, hallelujah. Give him praise in this house. Come on, stand up and give the King of Glory a big clap of praise. Hallelujah. Woo! Glory to God. Somebody ought to just praise him. Somebody ought to praise him. Somebody ought to praise him. He's the King. He sits on the throne of my heart. Woo! He sits on the throne of my heart is for him. Woo! Somebody said, "Who you pulling for?" I'm pulling for Jesus. Who's your favorite in this race, Jesus? Come on, preacher, quit being spiritual. Uh-uh. Because spirit, this is a spiritual warfare. And if I'm going to win, I'll be spiritual. Yeah. Shimbarabokoyanana. Woo! Here's what we're going to do. Can you make your way back? We living in a wicked, wicked time. But Jehu represents God's anointed. He told Elijah, "I want you to anoint Jehu. He's going to be king." Jehu comes in to the city. And that old spirit of control and rebellion's on the wall, painted up, powdered up. Yeah, she's 106, but she thinks she looks good with a little cover girl on. And she said, "Hey, J.U., you slew your master." She's just kind of derailing him. J.U. looks up to, hey, some eunuchs there beside her. It's been serving her. They've been bringing her nail polish, and they've been bringing her mascara, and probably talking about her behind her back. J.U. said, "Anybody on the Lord's side?" "Me? Throw that old spirit of control over." Some of you ain't got control over your life. But I can tell you, Jesus, you can gain control this morning. The Spirit of the Lord, He'll throw that thing out. I'm going to tell you, by the Spirit of God, I know some of you are where you said 10 years ago you'd never get. 10 years ago, you was making remarks about people who are right where you're at now. You were talking about how uncommitted they were. "Oh, I'll never get there." The Bible says you better not judge. Because if you judge where somebody's at, make sure you know that you're going to come right back around. I believe that some of you are under control of a spirit. It's not of the kingdom of God, but of this world. It's going to take some backbone. It's going to take some sheer guts to get up, walk up here and say, "Listen, I've had it. I've had it with my life being under the influence and control of this world system, and today I'm going to take control of this life. I'm going to allow the kingdom to set up." Listen, Jezebel had done a lot in her lifetime. Them eunuchs had seen her destroy Nahor, all of those. They saw that. Can you imagine having to choose between a little young guy that's claiming to be king and the one they done seen prove what she could do? I mean, she put the greatest prophet in Israel at the time, in Elijah, to running. Can you imagine the sheer faith that they had to have in the king? Woo! Some of you this morning said, "I can't do it. I've tried it before." That's that old ruling system. We're talking about a brand new king. We're talking about Jesus. You can give it to Him. You can begin your life anew today. Who among you is on the Lord's side? Throw her over. The Bible says those eunuchs tossed her over. Jehu just flanked his horse and went right on. Got in there and got to thinking about it. He said, "Somebody needs to go bury her." But the problem was, when they got there, Brother Doug, all they could find was the palms of her hands. A little of her skull. Why? Because God's prophecy had came to pass. "In the last days, saith God, I will pour my spirit out upon all flesh. Sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Young men shall dream dreams. Old men shall dream visions. Upon my servants and my handmaids will I pour out of my spirit." God's word will never return void. This is the hour. We've been living in the hour for about 2,000 years. This is the hour. God wants to pour His Spirit out in your life. The Bible tells us, as I conclude, that Samuel poured the oil on David. And the Spirit of the Lord came upon him. This morning in this house, I'm not even going to deal with all the things that could be going on. I'm just going to ask you this morning, as the Holy Spirit speaking to your heart, is He inviting you to come and pray around these altars? I don't even want to know this morning. I don't have to know, but you can come. You can lay it down. You can pick up life anew. The new King. A new Lord in your life this morning. Would you begin to make your way? I'm not going to go through the normal bow your head, raise your hand. I'm just going to ask you, would you come this morning? Anyone? Anyone say, Pastor, Holy Spirit's challenging me. I'm going to move into that challenge today. I'm going to tell you something. I've said some things, and I'm going to tell you right up front. You can get mad. I'm just going to be very plain and open with you. If I've said anything to offend you this morning, I've said it by the Holy Ghost. I believe that with all of my heart. And if you're offended, it could be that you're rejecting God's plea to you. I'm just going to... Oh, you said, Pastor, you don't think you're ever wrong? Oh, I've been wrong so many times. But I've been right too. And I know when I'm right. God's challenging some people. Listen, if God's going to bring the church back to the place where he died for it to be, He's going to challenge us. He's going to challenge this dead, dry form of religion that we've adapted and that we've become comfortable with. He's going to challenge us to throw that over the wall and let the King come in. One more time, does anybody want to come to these altars this morning and visit with the Lord? If you don't know Him as your Lord and Savior, come. Call on Him. Call on Him. Your heart. You know your heart's torn right now between things in this world and what God's wanting to do in your life. Ministries are being put on hold for things of this life. I've told this many, many times, and I'll tell it one more time. I'm going to let Brother Jimmy come. When I was dating my wife, we attended church where she was raised. There was the most precious gentleman in that church. That gentleman kept telling the pastor, when I get to where I'm trying to get, I get all of my finances, everything, and I get my everything to a certain point, I feel like the Lord wants me to help you. I feel like the Lord wants me to have a certain ministry. He said, but I just want to get everything in place, and then I'm going to do that. But tragedy struck before he ever got everything done in the world that he wanted to do. He was confined to a wheelchair the rest of his life. He was not able to fulfill those ministry plans that he had. I wonder what would have happened had he just forsook all and followed the calling of God in his life. It's important when the Lord begins to deal with us that we move in that. This morning, I want to challenge you, if you've laid ministry aside for other things that are not ministry oriented, It's time to pick that ministry up. I believe God's going to give you grace this morning to pick that ministry up. I want you to come right now. Holy Spirit's talking to somebody in this house. You've laid that ministry down. You're pursuing other things. But the Lord would have me to tell you this morning that He's given it to you to use for Him. And it's time to pick it up. Jesus.
Lord, I give you my heart, and I give you my soul, and I live for you alone.
God's speaking to your heart, sister.
Every breath that I take,
nothing but good things going to happen. Hallelujah.
Have your way.
If we be willing and obedient, we'll eat the good of the Lamb.
That's
what the Bible says.
I give you my soul.
I feel restoration coming to those ministry plans.
Couldn't figure out what it was. It just kept coming. It was, walk with me. Follow me. Walk with me. Lay down your sin. Walk with me.
Hey. Brother Brandon's not one that steps out. For him to obey God today, God's trying to get somebody's attention. We've got some ladies up here that come. They're fixing to pick up something that maybe they've laid on the shelf. Maybe something that they've been intimidated. Not necessarily laid down, but have been too intimidated by the enemy to have ever started. But God today is going to empower them. I want some of you ladies to come. Sister Betty, some of you ladies that like to come. Anybody, we're going to pray for them. God's speaking to you. When Brother Brandon was speaking just a moment ago, your heart began to just beat in your chest, and you know the Holy Spirit's talking to you. God loves you. That's why He's doing it. Loves you. There's some good things fixing to happen in your life. Not bad. I'm good if you'll just obey God. Just obey God. I'm going to anoint these with oil this morning. We're going to pray. Jesus. Anybody that wants to come, come. I just feel like saying this morning that a double portion needs to come. A double portion, Sister Faith. A double portion, Sister Regina. A double portion, Sister Heather.
Grandma, is she a little boy?
A double portion. Whew. Oh, glory. Oh, glory.